Dragon Con 2017, Crispy here, and I've got our good friend Lisa. Lisa.
Hello.
Thank you so much for making it to our little show.
I'm excited to be here. I've never been to Dragon Con.
Yeah, this is your first time at Dragon Con.
It is.
So that's going to be pretty exciting for you, I hope. I'm hoping it's exciting. I'm excited for you.
Well, the Henson family's been making a good showing over the last few years. So both my sisters, Heather and Cheryl, and my brother Brian have been here. So, and I think we're kind of committed that we're going to try to be here at least one of us as often as possible.
Just to show up and be like, hey, yes, we're supporting the puppetry community, but the dragon community as a whole.
We love the idea that puppetry is so popular at DragonCon, and we think it's great that the fans are supporting puppetry in this big way.
Yeah.
And we also love the tie-in with the Center for Puppetry Arts.
Oh, yeah, it's a beautiful partnership.
It's fantastic. Yeah. And we are also very closely connected with Center for Puppetry Arts. So if we can come down here, be involved with both organizations, it kind of works for us.
It's a big win.
Yeah.
So it's a big win, So, obviously here at Dragon, I'm a big puppetry fan.
Evidently, so I thought this was something you put out just for me, and then
you're not that special. You are. You are to me, though, to be fair. So, but yeah, personally, and our fans of the interviews know that I'm a huge proponent of puppetry, and I think it is one of the best tracks here in Atlanta, and we get some amazing people that come down and represent. So, personally, on behalf of myself and the convention, I'm really happy that you're here.
It's a little bit of a family reunion as well, not just for the Henson family, but puppeteers that we know, people we've worked with, like you just bump into them, and it's not the same, that's not the same way at another con.
No.
You know, so here it's like very homey for the puppetry people.
We try to keep you relaxed.
Yeah.
Work, sure, but make sure you're relaxed and enjoying yourself. So last night, though, you were at the Center for Puppetry Arts. You were doing the Labyrinth Ball. This is the second year we've done this, but this is the first year you've come down for that, obviously, because you
That's
weren't
right.
here last year. What were your initial thoughts about that?
They put on such a great ball at the Center for Puppetry Arts. I hope they continue this ball tradition. Because it's great to have like a sort of a formal event in the middle of Dragon Con, and it's kind of dressy, it's fancy. We have a judged costume contest and prizes, of course.
Ooh, prizes.
Yeah, prizes. They had an amazing thing at this ball where they had, I think they had auctioned off ultra VIP tickets.
Oh, wow.
And if you were an ultra VIP, you got to sit on a special throne. They had four thrones at the end of the room.
Okay, like Jareth thrones, I'm assuming.
Jareth thrones.
Yeah,
it happened that all the ultra VIPs were women. So it was sort of like these four queens
That's
of
beautiful.
The ball.
Yes.
They each had their own throne, and then they were given a goblin servant, a server, a waiter in a goblin outfit who brought them drinks and food throughout the night.
They just took care of them.
Isn't that amazing?
I knew a lot about this event. That I did not know.
It would
That's
be worth
incredible.
Paying extra for that, right?
Yeah, I'm a little jealous I'm here during that event now, even more so than before. What was
but we it? Judged the contest.
Yeah.
Toby Froud and I judged, and he has not been here in that capacity either, so it was a lot of fun for both of us. He did not show up dressed as Toby the baby,
but
sort
I would
of more
not.
Like Toby the grown-up goblin or something. And the costumes were incredible. There was a full-size Ludo that somebody made, and they actually learned how to do animatronics and fiberglass and everything just to do this particular costume.
So we're talking like a one-to-one scale, like...
Yeah, just
walking,
about.
I wish I... Again,
it was incredible. And everybody who went, of course, took their pictures with him, and then it was not a huge surprise that costume won.
Right. Would you put that much level of detail, passion into that? I mean, when you're doing I'm not downplaying any costumes here, but inspirations obviously are one thing, but to do a recreation is a beast unto itself.
It is.
And so that must have been...
But we also love the interpretations. Because one of the other winners was a couple who came as the wall and the worm.
Oh, wonderful.
And it was so great. Like, the gentleman had a suit that looked like covered with bricks, and he had a headgear with eyeballs coming out of it like the wall in Labyrinth, and then his date was dressed as the worm with an amazing blue wig and a caterpillar dress.
That's
so like
wonderful.
That was a great kind of creative interpretation that we love too.
That's I hope
could talk about costumes forever. Do you think
that's
I belong
totally
here?
Fine, yeah. I was gonna say I hope Karen sees that, because that sounds just like we've had Karen a couple of times now. That sounds like something she would go gaga for.
The worm was really popular
as
a character.
Yeah, which is obviously I'm not involved in that project, but you think just this small little moment, but it's such an endearing,
friendly
design. You know, very lovely.
And there were very few Jareths.
I actually do find that surprising.
Yes.
Because usually at the convention, Jareth for a long time was, we have an ongoing like Deadpool tradition here. Deadpool is the simple costume. You see a lot of them. Jareth's for a long time. Ladies, men, who just constantly Jareth's everywhere.
And did they have Jareth, like, meetups with lots of Jareths?
I think that would be awesome if they did. Especially if they do any contact juggling just for extra kicks. That
there
would
was
be
a
legal.
Contact juggler
oh,
last
no
night.
Way.
Yes.
Oh, goodness.
Oh, all I want to do is keep pitching this event so people will go to it
come
next
back
year.
And,
yeah.
and enjoy it. No, I'm totally fine with that. So obviously you are not just, I guess, your dragon. I know we're focusing a lot on the center, but that's mostly what I want to talk about. Dark Crystal, you guys were shooting there a lot of behind the scenes. I heard you were taking puppets out of cases and doing some close-up stuff. What kind of projects were you working on with that? I know a lot of people, we already might know, but.
Well, actually, the reason we were shooting the puppets at the Center for Puppetry Arts is I was doing some added value footage for Sony's 4K Ultra HD re-release. So,
nice.
Yeah, so we've actually done a great restoration of Dark Crystal, and it's something that we're doing with a lot of our library. So we now, the Fraggle Rock that airs on HBO right now is a beautifully restored version of Fraggle Rock.
Yes,
it looks
gorgeous.
Great. And then we will soon be doing Storyteller as well.
Oh, goodness. That's
oh,
my
I'm glad you know
favorite.
What Storyteller is.
Storyteller for me is my personal favorite thing.
Really?
Yeah,
Storyteller
yeah.
is the one that I helped create.
Oh, fantastic.
Yes.
So this is a fun moment here. Yeah.
I was a folklore and mythology major in college.
Those stories specifically were an integral part of my childhood.
Amazing.
So, yeah.
Well, not that many people know. I mean, it has a cult following.
Right, right.
But
I'm definitely
because
a part of that
there
cult.
Were only, I think there were only 10 or 13 episodes.
With John, I think there was like 10 episodes, and then you brought on Derek Jacobi for the Greek stuff. And
It wasn't Derek Jacobi. It was I forgot his name. The cook, the thief.
We're confusing.
I can't not know this.
Yeah, this is embarrassing. We're not going to have this on tape. But yeah, I've got all of those collections. Very integral part. Obviously, there was the, now we've stumbled and my brain's going, what was my favorite one? But it was the...
Was your
the,
favorite one Soldier and Death?
Soldier and Death is, I think, everyone's popular one.
Because my father directed it.
Fair enough.
And it had great puppetry. It had the beautiful little devil puppets. Mm. And those were kind of special non-Muppety puppets that everybody just loved those because they're rod puppets, very different from a typical, like what you would think of as like a Muppet hand puppet.
And
I think the only hand puppet that even appeared in that whole show was the dog, the storyteller dog that my brother Brian performed.
Which is on display at the center. By the way, the dog is there, so.
Yeah, that dog and Sprocket from Fraggle Rock are both on
We've got the whole canine family just kind of hanging out there, which is excellent. So we're going to got to wrap things up because I know we have a very busy schedule.
We could just talk about everything.
I'm totally fine with that.
But if you want to know more about Dark Crystal, I have a Dark Crystal publishing panel talking about all the books and graphic novels and the ways that we've expanded the Dark Crystal universe in the last, this is a recent effort.
Last 3 or 4 years, I think?
Maybe about 5 years.
We've
been working in publishing to kind of build out that world, and then it's leading to other things.
Excellent.
And I also have a Dark Crystal fan panel talking about how we've been doing great fan contests the last few years as well. So it
has been an excellent community, and again, as a fan of the Dark Crystal, I'm excited that there's this resurgence that you guys are doing. So I know that I'm going to be excited and happy, and I think the fans are going to be as well.
Okay, great.
And you're going to hear a lot of that this weekend. So let's wrap things up a little bit. This is our friend Randall. I believe you met Randall
before.
Okay, bye, Randall. So Randall's got these random questions.
Oh, should
collected.
I pick?
You get to dig from the fishbowl, find one at random, no pressure. All the pressure.
Should I read it?
Yes, read it out loud, and then we're going to answer the question.
If you could be fluent in a fictional language of any universe, which would you choose?
Wow, that's a pretty deep one.
That is a deep one.
I'm not as affluent with the multiverses. Do you have a particular one?
Well, it's interesting. We have been working on this with Dark Crystal.
Oh, fantastic.
Yes. And, the only fictional language in Dark Crystal that we really kind of are continuing with is the Podling language. So now I'd like to speak Podling. There was a funny thing I'll tell you so quickly that the Skeksis and the Podlings and the Mystics, they all spoke fictional languages in the original Dark Crystal.
Yeah, I remember that,
But they had to get rid of the Skeksis language because when they previewed the movie for the public, people were totally mystified. They couldn't even follow the story at all.
Oh, goodness.
So they had to replace all the Skeksis language with English.
That's a shame.
So it's a dead language.
It is
quite literally. It's an ancient dead language.
Sign me up to learn Skeksis then, and you can do the Podling. And I would love to live in this universe. So we'll make that happen. So Lisa,
all right, great
I'm so happy to have you here. Thank you so much. And DragonCon, we'll see you soon.